The wave of Korean popular culture has spread across the world and increased its global popularity since the 1990s. One of the most prolific ones was their Korean movies. In 2019, a Korean film titled Parasite was released. The following year, the film made history when it became the first non-English language film to win the Academy Award for Best Picture.
And the Oscar goes to Parasite.
How can a Korean movie compete in such prestigious events and receive such international recognition? We're gonna find out on Theory of Everything. On this program, we will make a breakdown from the most controversial conspiracy theories in the world, the dark side of your favorite TV programs, and perhaps the unsung story of your top lead singer of all time. So stay tuned and happy binge watching for Theory of Everything. Today we're going to break down our theory on Parasite, a Korean film with a history that has touched millions of souls across the world. We will tell you about the story behind its creation and some secret symbols that skillfully crafted in the film by its creator. Parasite is a thriller film with a story that follows poor family who seem to become employed by a wealthy family and infiltrate their household by posing as unrelated, highly qualified individuals. It's a film that fully teems with social dilemma between the demanding rich Park family and the empathic, smart, impoverished but born poor Kim's family. Parasite criticizes the inequality gap that already deepening in South Korea nowadays. In some scene of the film, Bong Joon-ho as its director skillfully crafted metaphors to convey the situations. Central metaphors in the symbolism-rich movie are the stairs. Bong views stairways as a crucial tool in conveying the message of social mobility to his audience. Our characters are constantly seen going up and down the stairs depending on their positions in the social hierarchy. The most impressive example to show the contrast between the wealthy and the poor, probably the sequence of the scenes in which we followed Kim escaping the Park mansion in what almost seems like a never-ending journey of descending an infinite number of stairs. Another example of metaphor to convey about social dilemma of the character is Scholar Stone. In Korea, it's common to place a Scholar Stone in public garden or entranceway as a lucky charm. In the film, the stone was given to Kim Ki-woo, one of the lead characters, as a gift by his friend Min Hyuk. Indeed, it brings luck for the family for a brief moment, until they meet a disastrous problem. When it's raining and they are at the basement, the home was flooded. The stone seems to be floating and it proved to be fake. Some argue that subtle symbol placed by Bong to represent the empty promises of social mobility in a capitalistic society. Another metaphor about social class that Bong tried to imply is on the film's title itself, Parasite. A question rises from the audience who considered as the real parasite in the films. Is it Kim's or Park's family? To answer the questions, let's break down another theory. There are numerous examples in which Kim's are alluded as being parasite in the movie, foreshadowing a future events. Chung-sook compares her husband Ki-taek to a cockroach at one point. The bug extermination scene at the beginning of the film is another example. However, Parks are the ones who are incapable of doing what most of us consider as basic and everyday chores. In that sense, the Parks are dependent on the hard labor of the Kims, giving them only small and meaningless amount of their money in return. In an interview on the media, Bong revealed that the word parasite indeed has a double meaning. Aside from describing the poor leeching money of the rich, the Park's family is also a parasite, without the ability to wash the dishes or tidy their house. They use their money to exploit poor family with their cheap labor. In a way, they, too, are parasites in society. Another hidden message from Bong is also talking about the crack that is happening right now in our society. In the film, the Park's family son, Dong Song's really passionate for Indians, which are actually Native Americans. It was shown throughout the movies. This is a major hint to the ironic message that the long, complicated history of Native American has been reduced to a child's hobby with little meaning. It's mirroring today's society, fired up by the trend of social media that many people nowadays are living in a fast-paced, instant lifestyle, yet they are having little understanding about history and ignore the core values of humanity. Move on to the other theory. Parasite has won Best Picture on the Academy Awards, including several other categories. All of them are record-breaking both in Korea and abroad. Bong and his co-writer Han Jin-won has won Best Original Screenplay at the Academy and became the first Asian to win it. In other categories such as Best Picture, Best Director, and Best International Feature Films, it was the first for Korean to win those categories. Parasite deserves Oscar winning, and that appraisal comes for some reasons, some of which are a pitch-perfect team. Parasite doesn't just have something to say, but it says it artfully, says Vox journalist Alyssa Wilkinson. The other reason is Parasite filled with top acting ensemble, from a sly, rather occultist father who struggled to provide his family, Kim Ki-taek, played by Song Kang-ho, to Mr. Park, the head of the Park household, who is generally a congenial but snobbish, obsessed with keeping his employees controlled, played by Lee Soon-kyun. Although all of them didn't get individual trophies from the 92nd Academy Award, they already bagged the Screen Actors Guild Award in the previous year. It becomes proof that their acting also played a significant role for helping Parasite's historic Oscar moment. Their critically acclaimed performance must become hand-in-hand with the direction of Bong Joon-ho. Without Bong's skillful directing counterpart, they might be unable to unleash their true potential. Bong Joon-ho was born in Daegu, South Korea on September 14, 1969. He is the youngest of four children. He grew up from a middle-class family. His father, Bong Sang-gyun, was a professor of art at Yongnam University, and his mother, Park So-young, was a full-time housewife. Throughout his entire career in filmmaking, Bong characterized for making films with emphasis on social themes, some of which are Mother, a film that premiered in 2009, tells a story of a doting mother who struggles to save her disabled son from a murder accusation. Later on in 2013, Bong made his debut in an English language film called Snowpiercer. It is based on the graphic novel Le Transpersonnage by Zach Loeb and Jung Ma-Rochette. Another film from Bong with social theme is Okja. The film was a joint production between the Plan B Entertainment and Netflix with a budget of $50 million. Bong's altruism towards social theme in many of his works perhaps coming from his educational background. He studied sociology at Yonsei University and later completed a two-year program at the Korean Academy of Film Arts. Coming up next, we will show you more breakdown on another theory, so stay tuned. Welcome back to Theory of Everything. Don't we love all good truth, facts, and meaning behind every our favorite popular culture? Well, here it is. This is the time where we will serve you the absolute perfect theory and reveal the meaning behind something that's going on. This time we will give you every detail we got about the most happening movie of all time, Fast and Furious. First, let me drive you back to the year of 2006, where one particular song is probably the identity of the movie until now. I bet you knew these songs already. Yes, it's the popular Fast and Furious Tokyo Drift movie anthem in 2006. So every time you hear this song, probably that comes out in your mind was you driving like crazy lunatic with a cool car and nitrogens in your car. Well, that's probably never going to happen. Despite the popular song featured in the Fast and Furious 3, aka Tokyo Drift, this third movie in particular seems to be pretty forgettable, as many people say. But is it really true? Anyway, who doesn't know Fast and the Furious franchise, right? It's filled with fancy cars, great dialogues.
Thing about street fights, the street always wins.
Action scenes and crazy stunts. Everything you would want in a movie. Well, at least from the last five, I guess. But Tokyo Drift seems a bit... what's the word to say? Tokyo Drift seems like the weakest movie in the franchise, because it doesn't feature any characters from the first movie. Even it only has one very minor cameo after the plot conclude. And you know who the cameo is. A little bit fact about the Fast and the Furious title is actually taken from the 1995 movie by Roger Corman with the same title, The Fast and the Furious. And the funny story behind it really is that Roger didn't even ask for the money. He just wanted to have all access to Universal Studios' stock footage library. And guess what? They agreed. Okay, now let's talk about how the first movie and the sequel itself. Why it seems pretty okay rather than the third movie. The first movie of The Fast and the Furious tells more about how both Dominic Toretto, played by Vin Diesel, and Brian O'Connor, played by Paul Walker, both became closer like a brother. Even though later Dominic finds out that Brian was an undercover cop, before racing it out and literally calling it even. Overall, we all get it why it's beloved street rendition of Point Break of a bromance that would have eventually built into a franchise that would surpass it. The bad news was Vin Diesel denied $25 million to play for the Fast and Furious sequel, mentioning that the script was really bad. Meanwhile, Paul Walker returned as Brian for the second movie, which called Too Fast, Too Furious. But overall, it's goofy, it's not the best, but seeing the franchise reach its point and then becoming what it is now, it's kind of a glow up. Let's be honest here, let's just first compare the first four movies of The Fast and the Furious and the last five movies. It's pretty big difference, starting from the plot, the cars, even the storyline. Technically, 4, 5, and 6 was supposed to be its own trilogy, where 7, 8, and 9 were going to be another one. That obviously been slightly altered. It also important to remember that Tokyo Drift takes place after 6, so the right chronological order to watch Fast and the Furious was supposed to be Fast Furious 1, 2, 4, 5, 6, and 3. Then we come 7, 8, and 9. Now let's talk about the Fast 5. This is one that just became the new franchise in my opinion. You get The Rock in a movie, moving to another country, and it is crazy. This is the one they really become a team. A familia, if you will. This is the first time these two embrace each other, since Mia about to have a child. They bring back Ludacris and Tyrese, and also Gal Gadot, who became the Wonder Woman. But the best part is easily when Vin Diesel and The Rock fight each other. So now let's talk about the final of the first trilogy, The Fast and the Furious 6. This movie was supposed to be so long, they wanted to split it into two parts. And this is the interesting thing. The first part is supposed to be called The Fast, and with the second part called The Furious. Isn't that a good idea for a movie title? Well, The Fast Furious 6 is where the action goes wilder, with so many things happen between the familia. And also, this is where Joe Taslim appear, beating up guys for the first time on the Fast and the Furious set. This is the starting point of Fast and Furious become a most likely Mission Impossible wannabe, and the fighting scene were WWE level.
It's been a long day without you, my friend, and I'll tell you all about it when I see you again.
This song, I bet you listened to it 100 times. Furious 7 was the fastest movie to reach billions at a time, and the second most illegally streamed after Interstellar. Obviously, there is so much going on here in FF7, and the last movie of Paul Walker before his death, and that held up the productions at a time. This movie happened after the Tokyo Drift movie, and connect all the dots who kill Hans that moment. Let's be real here, nobody watches Fast and the Furious movies for the cars themselves anymore. You watch them because the cars fly out of the airplanes and chase down submarines, and all the while the people driving are catching missiles with their bare hands and firing rocket launchers at the helicopters. At this point, the car are simply a means to ridiculous end. I can say those things because that's all also what happened to the Fast and Furious 8 and 9. The first 10 minutes of the Fate of the Furious have everything that you could ever ask for in a Fast and Furious movie. Or any other movie for that matter. The villainous plot is so stupid that the film tries to pretend it doesn't matter. Not so fast, not so furious after all. And don't let me start talking about Furious 9. F9 isn't just a cruddy mess of white noise, it's a painfully inert film that feels like a bad parody. One can only look helplessly as a decade's worth of goodwill tumbles down a hill and bursts into flames like so many sports cars of years gone by. Even now, Fast and Furious fans need to finally admit it, that haters are right.
How in the hell are you not dead?
Having a blast, aren't we? That is all from us. How was it? Do you like the ride of facts and truth? If yes, stay tuned for more ride to your favorite pop culture. Hi, and this is Theory of Everything. We love to uncover everything behind the famous popular culture that is currently happening. It will probably from the past, present, or even the future. This time we will uncover another popular songs, from the facts, true meaning behind it, or rumors about it. So let's get started! First of all, how do you feel when you hear this James Blunt song?
You're beautiful, it's true.
However, when we look back at the 7-year-old pop classic that is James Blunt's You're Beautiful, aka one of the 21st century most saccharine wedding song for hundreds, if not thousands of couples, you can't help but think how deeply passionate and romantic the song is. Featured on his 2004 album called Back to Bedlam, there is some particular story behind the lyric itself. Blunt revealed the origin story behind the beloved song, and it's not quite as hopelessly romantic as you think. In an interview, James told that the music he was writing is about him stalking somebody else's girlfriend, referring to the first intro of his songs.
She smiled at me on the subway, she was with another man.
Despite the mostly adored love song for the past 15 years or so, the inspiration behind it could be described as a tad creepy. Anyway, upon its release, Your Beautiful made Blunt a household name around the world, as a single reached number 1 in the UK, Canada, Belgium, Norway, Netherlands, and Italy. So, next time you hear this song, don't be creeped out, it's still gonna be the best wedding song you've ever heard. Our next song on the list is Humbop by Hanson. This music performed by the Hanson brothers, featured on their album called Middle of Nowhere, released in 1997. This trio brothers catches the people's ears and was one of the biggest hits in the late 90s. Being the biggest hit in that era, people who grew up listening to the catchy song have always wondered what it meant. But most of us didn't realize that the song is actually kind of depressing. Let's listen to the first intro lyrics. The band member reveals the truth about the song. They say that Humbop is ironically happy. It says most things in life are going to fade away, and most of the things that you think are important are going to be gone. Well, that's a song to catch at a time of the year. Who doesn't know this popular band from England? Have you ever heard this song from them?
Blackbird singing in the dead of night. Take these broken wings and learn to fly. All your life you were only waiting for this moment to arrive.
This song is featured in White Album from the Beatles, released in 1968, written by John Lennon and McCartney. This song actually wasn't about a bird at all. Paul McCartney wrote the song after hearing about the civil rights struggle for African American. McCartney did not have any intentions when he wrote this song. In England, bird is the term, the meaning for girls. So the song is a message to a black girl, telling her it's her time to fly. This was really a song from him to black women experiencing this problem in the States, to encourage them to keep trying, to keep their faith, because there is hope. It's a beautiful song for the world peace. Another particular song is from one of the Beatles members.
Imagine there's no heaven. See if you try.
John Lennon's Imagine is arguably the most loved song of all time. The song is actually self-explanatory. Well, seems like this song is inspired from the Forrest Gump, or probably the other way around. Anyway, from this song, John is asking the listener to imagine a world without possession, borders, and religion, suggesting that these things cause conflict. So without them, war would become obsolete and pointless, leading to the ultimate peace. But regardless of the true meaning of the song, people assume this song as a nasty one. Many say that it's a communist anthem, and people assume that Lennon was a lifelong communist. And he did let his ideology sign on these songs. Let's try to connect the dots here. In the lyric of Imagine, Lennon also said something like this.
Imagine there's no country.
No wonder people assume that this song is a communist song. Despite the controversial surrounding, people still think this song is beautiful. John Lennon might be not a perfect person when he was alive, but people still appreciate his songwriting talent. And this song is one of his best works. It's a very simple and flawed ideal. You may say he's a dreamer, but he's not the only one. This next song is from our favorite girl that grew up from Disney. Yep, it's Selena Gomez.
To love, love you, to love, love you, to love you.
The fans speculated ahead of the song's release was probably about her with Justin Bieber. Since she's Taylor's best friend, and song is probably way of them to recover from the heartbreaks. Well, we're just gonna leave it there then. Last but not least, this popular song from 2013, Royals by Lorde.
And we'll never be royals. It's a run in our blood. That kind of luck just ain't for us.
You all know these songs, alright? The song Royals by Lorde is about simplicity and turning away from the typical life of superstar. She sings about how she has no need for too many material things in the world. This song wins many awards in 2014, and Lorde became more popular since then. The funny story behind the title Royals itself is when Lord saw a 1976 picture of Kansas City Royals baseball player George Brett when he wears a shirt with the word Royals on it. Now, Lord is a Royals alright. How was it? Are you bummed yet? Are you probably still hungry for more information about your favorite pop culture? Then give us your feedback and see you in another pop culture moment.